Clarion Books and Harper Audio present The Lemonade War, Book 1 of the Lemonade War series by Jacqueline Davies, performed by Rebecca Soler.
For Tom, Kim, and Leslie, all roads lead back. Chapter 1. Slump. Slump. Noun. A drop in the activity of a business or the economy. Evan lay on his back in the dark, throwing the baseball up in a straight line and catching it in his bare hands. Thwap. Thwap. The ball made a satisfying sound as it slapped his palm. His legs flopped in a V, his arms stretched up to the ceiling. And the thought that if he missed, he'd probably break his nose made the game just interesting enough to keep going. On the floor above, he heard footsteps, his mother's, and then a long, loud, scraping, groaning sound. He stopped throwing the ball to listen. His mother was dragging something heavy across the kitchen floor. Probably the broken air conditioner. A week ago, right at the beginning of the heat wave, the air conditioner in his mother's attic office had broken. The man from Sears had installed a brand new one, but left the old one sitting right in the middle of the kitchen floor. The Treskis had been walking around it all week. Scrape! Evan stood up. His mom was strong, but this was a two-person job. Hopefully, she wouldn't ask him why he was hiding in the dark basement. And hopefully Jessie wouldn't be in the kitchen at all. He'd been avoiding her for 2 days now, and it was getting harder by the minute. The house just wasn't that big. Evan had his hand on the railing when the scraping noise stopped. He heard footsteps fading to silence. She'd given up. Probably the heat, he thought. It was that kind of weather. Giving up kind of weather. He went back to lying on the floor. Thwap. Thwap. Then he heard the basement door open. Pshh. Evan caught the ball and froze. Evan? Jessie's voice sounded echoey in the darkness. Evan, you down there? Evan held his breath. He lay completely still. The only thing that moved was the pins and needles prickling in his fingers. He heard the door start to close. Long breath out. But then it stopped and opened again. Footsteps on the carpeted stairs. A black outline of Jessie standing on the bottom step with daylight squirting all around her. Evan didn't move a muscle. Evan, is that you? Jessie took one short step into the basement. Is that? She inched her way toward him, then kicked him with her bare foot. Hey! Watch it, would ya? Said Evan, swatting her leg. He suddenly felt stupid lying there in the dark. I thought you were a sleeping bag, she said. I couldn't see. What are you doing down here? How come the lights are off? It's too hot with the lights on, he said. He talked in a flat voice, trying to sound like the most boring person on the whole planet. If he kept it up, Jessie might just leave him alone. Mom's back in her office, said Jessie, lying down on the couch. Working. She groaned as she said the word. Evan didn't say anything. He went back to throwing the ball. Straight up? Straight down. Maybe silence would get Jessie to leave. He was starting to feel words piling up inside him, crowding his lungs, forcing out all the air. It was like having a chest full of bats, beating their wings, fighting to get out. She tried to move the air conditioner, but it's too heavy, said Jessie. Evan tightened up his lips. Go away, he thought. Go away before I say something mean. It's gonna be hot all week, Jessie continued. In the 90s, all the way up till Labor Day. Thwap. Thwap. So what do you want to do? Jessie asked. Scream, thought Evan. Jessie never got it when you were giving her the big freeze. She just went right on acting as if everything were great. It made it really hard to tell her to bug off without telling her to bug off. Whenever Evan did that, he felt bad. "So what do you want to do?" Jessie asked again, nudging him with her foot. It was a direct question. Evan had to answer it or explain why he wouldn't. And he couldn't get into that. It was too complicated. Too hurtful. "Huh? So what do you want to do?" she asked for the third time. "Doing it," said Evan. "Nah, come on, for real." "For real," he said. "We could ride our bikes to the 7-Eleven," she said. "No money," he said. "You just got $10 from Grandma for your birthday." "Spent it," said Evan. "On what?" "Stuff," Evan said. "Well, I've got, well." Jessie's voice dribbled down to nothing. Evan stopped throwing the ball and looked at her. "What?" Jessie pulled her legs tight to her chest. "Nothing," she said. "Right," said Evan. He knew that Jessie had money. Jessie always had money squirreled away in her lockbox. But that didn't mean she was going to share it. Evan went back to throwing the baseball. He felt a tiny flame of anger shoot up and lick his face. Thwap. Thwap.
"We could build a fort in the woods," said Jessie.
"Too hot."
"We could play Stratego."
"Too boring."
"We could build a track and race marbles."
"Too stupid."
A thin spider web of sweat draped itself over his forehead, spreading into his hair. With every throw, he told himself, "It's not her fault." But he could feel his anger growing. He started popping his elbow to put a little more juice on the ball. It was flying a good 4 feet into the air every time. Straight up, straight down. Pop, thwap. Pop, thwap. The bats in his chest were going nuts.
"What is the matter with you?" asked Jessie. "You've been so weird the last couple of days."
"Oh man, here they come."
"I just don't want to play a dumb game like Stratego," he said. "You like Stratego. I only picked that because it's your favorite game. I was being nice in case you hadn't noticed."
"Look, there are only 6 days left of summer, and I'm not going to waste them playing a dumb game."
Evan felt his heartbeat speed up. Part of him wanted to stuff a sock in his mouth, and part of him wanted to deck his sister.
"It's a stupid game, and it's for babies, and I don't want to play a stupid baby game." Pop, thwap. Pop, thwap. "Why are you being so mean?"
Evan knew he was being mean, and he hated being mean, especially to her. But he couldn't help it. He was so angry and so humiliated and so full of bats, there was nothing else he could be. Except alone. And she'd taken even that away from him.
"You're the genius," he said. "You figure it out."
Good. That would shut her up. For once. Evan watched the ball fly in the air.
"Is this because of the letter?" Jessie asked. Crack.
Evan had taken his eyes off the ball for 1 second, just for 1 second, and the ball came crashing down on his nose.
Crud! Oh, crud!
He curled over onto his side, grabbing his nose with both hands. There was a blinding, blooming pain right behind his eyes that was quickly spreading to the outer edges of his skull.
"Do you want some ice?" he heard Jessie ask in a calm voice. "What do you think?" he shouted.
"Yeah?" she stood up.
"No, I don't want any stupid ice."
The pain was starting to go away. Like a humongous wave that crashes with a lot of noise and spray, but then slowly fizzles away into nothing. Evan rolled to a sitting position and took his hands away from his nose. With his thumb and index finger, he started to pinch the bridge. Was it still in a straight line? Jessie peered at his face in the dim light.
"You're not bleeding," she said.
"Yeah, well, it hurts," he said. "A lot."
"It's not broken," she said.
"You don't know that," he said.
You don't know everything you know. You think you do, but you don't.
It's not even swollen. You're making a big deal out of nothing.
Evan held his nose with one hand and hit his sister's knee with the other. Then he picked up the baseball and struggled to his feet.
Leave me alone. I came down here to get away from you, and you just had to follow. You ruin everything. You ruined my summer, and now you're going to ruin school. I hate you.
When he got to the bottom of the steps, he threw the baseball down in disgust. Thud. Chapter 2. Breakup. Breakup. Noun. Dissolution of a unit, an organization, or a group of organizations. The Justice Department sometimes forces the breakup of a large corporation into several smaller companies. Jessie didn't get it. She just didn't get it. What was Evan's problem? He'd been acting like a weirdo for 2 days now, and it was 2 days ago that the letter had arrived. But why would he be so upset about that letter?
This is a puzzle, Jessie told herself, and I'm good at puzzles.
But it was a puzzle about feelings, and Jessie knew that feelings were her weakest subject. Jessie sat in the cool darkness of the basement and thought back to Monday, the day the letter had come. Everything had been normal. She and Evan were putting together a lemonade stand in the driveway when the mailman walked up and handed Jessie a bundle of letters. Evan never bothered to look at the mail, but Jessie was always entering contests and expecting to win, so she flipped through the letters right away.
Boring, 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 said Jessie as each letter flashed by.
Hey, something from school, addressed to Mom.
She held up a plain white envelope.
What do you think it is?
Dunno, said Evan.
He was in the garage uncovering the small wooden table they usually used for a stand. It was buried under 2 snow tubes, 2 boogie boards, and the garden hose. Jessie watched while Evan gave a mighty pull and lifted the table up over his head.
Wow, he's gotten so big, thought Jessie,
remembering what Mom had said about Evan's growth spurt. Sometimes Jessie felt like Evan was growing twice as fast as she was. Growing up, growing away.
It looks important, said Jessie.
It looks like bad news, is what she thought in her head. Was there a problem? A complaint? A mix-up?
All the nervousness she'd been feeling about skipping to 4th grade suddenly burbled up inside her.
This table's really dirty, said Evan. Do you think we can just cover it with a lot of cups and the pitcher and no one will notice?
Jessie looked. The table was streaked with black.
No.
Evan groaned.
I'll clean it, said Jessie.
Evan had only agreed to have a lemonade stand because it was one of her favorite things to do. The least she could do for him was clean the gunk off the table.
Maybe, she said, holding up the envelope again. They're postponing school. Maybe the first day isn't going to be next Tuesday, you think?
That got Evan's attention.
Let's ask Mom to open it, he said.
Up in the humming cool of her office, Mrs. Treski read the letter through once. Well, she said, this is a curveball. She looked right at Evan. Jessie thought her face looked worried. Evan, you and Jessie are going to be in the same class this year. You'll both have Mrs. Overton. Jessie felt relief flood her entire body.
The same class. If she could have wished for one thing in the whole world, that's what she would have wished for. She would be with Evan, and Evan would make everything easier. He would introduce her to all those 4th graders. He would show them all that she was okay, not some puny 2nd grader who didn't really belong.
But Evan didn't look happy. He looked angry.
Why? He asked in an almost shouting voice.
Mrs. Treski scanned the letter. Well, the classes were small to start with, and now some of the 4th graders they thought would be attending aren't because they're moving or switching to private schools. So they need to combine the 2 small classes into 1 bigger class.
That is so unfair, said Evan. I wanted Mrs. Scobie, and I don't want...
He looked at Jessie.
That is so unfair.
Jessie was surprised. This was great news. Why didn't Evan see that? They always had fun together at home. Now they could have fun in school, too.
It'll be fun, she said to Evan.
It will not be fun, said Evan. School isn't fun.
And then he stomped downstairs.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.